Government is very concerned. Government is very, very worried. Every time that the school calendar is disrupted, it has its costs on the nation, and particularly the idle time our children spend can lead to a lot of social difficulties. So government is truly very, very concerned. We don't want school calendars to be disrupted. And like I said, a lot of discussion, serious negotiations have been going on between the federal government and ASU. And we believe that we should, you know, record some progress soon enough for these schools to open. And the Minister of Labor and the Minister of Education will be giving further briefs on the progress of these negotiations. And I know that it has never ceased since the strike started.
Danikere joins us now. He's of the Department of Philosophy, University of Lagos. Morning, and thank you for coming on today. By the way, what's the latest perspective on this ASU strike?
Well, it's still the same old story. They are meeting and meeting and meeting. That's the latest. And each time we hear, you know, Gabriel Suswan, after the meeting, come out to tell us that there is hope, they will soon call off. I don't know whether he's the one that will call the strike off. You know, so far there hasn't been anything meaningful, you know, progress made. Because
he has to be optimistic, shouldn't he?
Yeah, you don't just get optimistic out of nothing.
But it's predicated on something.
So what is it predicated on? Because if there are
Minister of Finance joined the meeting, ministers joined, and so...
No, to say that the Minister of Finance joined the meeting, that now brings some hope to me.
Yeah, in terms of they'll consider the finances, because it's not his department, so the appropriate quarters... The message is going to the appropriate quarters.
But I get worried when they say they are considering the finances and what have you. Were they not considered before they signed the agreement? This is government we're talking about. Because initially they came out to say that this agreement, you know, predated this government. I see government is no longer a continuum. You know, it's worrisome when people in leadership position begin to talk in this manner. This is an agreement that the government of the Federal Republic of Nigeria entered into with ASU. And you cannot tell me that those who signed the agreement were so unreasonable.
Yeah, but
that they never considered the financial implications.
The ASU president wouldn't speak to journalists. He referred them to Gabriel Suswan, who you spoke about. So if he was going to say anything wrong, shouldn't the ASU president have been there to say, well, actually, this is the current position?
No. He has not said anything. But that does not mean that he's, you know, quarreling with the press. Oh, now, I think the problem he's really having is that the man is actually, you know, worried about the kind of attitude of government. You know, the lying and the rest of it. You know, at the initial stage, we were made to understand that even the secretary of government of the federation was kind of having an attitude of whether they actually signed the agreement, looking at the agreement, okay, yes, something like this, that kind of attitude. You know, it's worrisome. I remember in one of our meetings, in fact, somebody suggested that they should be insulting them as part of the negotiation, you know, attitude. Because without that, they don't even realize that you're insulting a whole, intellectuals.
And that wouldn't get them anywhere.
No, neither will even get anybody anywhere either. You know, this is not an issue of pay or salary. It's an issue of make the system work so that the state can be sound. It's not just about the individuals involved. It's about the country as a whole. These are people who pass through the university system, and I'm not sure this was how it was when they had their time. Why do you want to destroy it for the coming generation?
Assuming these agreements were if they fulfill this agreement they signed in 2009.
Yes.
Will there ever be any other ASU strike?
In fact, there should be no reason for a strike.
If they meet up with this 2009 agreement?
Of course.
So once and for all?
No. You see, the agreement itself has provided means of addressing issues from time to time. So if they're able to meet up with it, there will be no room for strike at all. And so it's an all-embracing, you know, something that equally provided for renegotiation after a period. So once those things, they are not saying they will impose, you renegotiate. So whatever they agree on after that becomes a position to take off from. So there shouldn't be any basis for strike at all. I'm not sure any academic is actually interested in strike.
Help us connect the dots with what's going on with the intermittent disruption of academic activities and the quality of leadership that we get time and again. Because now we hear them talking back and forth about generations and leadership.
Sometimes when you look at it from this angle, you know, you find some of these men, you know, who have made so much from the state, established different companies here and there, you know, with the hope that their children will step in. You know, a number of times, they don't even leave the scene for the children. The reason is because they don't trust the system that has produced these children. You know, but who is responsible for that problem? They are. No, because the ideal thing is that you should be able to breed a child and repose confidence in the child. So if you have destroyed the system, how are they going to build the kind of competence that you're looking for? That is why they keep stealing. So the mentality of stealing is actually founded on something like that. You continue to steal because you are not too sure that this child can sustain what you have taken to the point that you will not tomorrow begin to ask for, you know, arms to survive. You know, these are the kind of problems. Ordinarily, every academic is interested in an uninterrupted, you know, academic calendar. You know, but with this kind of situation whereby somebody is working, you know, system is not well funded. Could you imagine that even to go on go for conferences, you need to look for loans
to go on conferences?
I'm telling you, there are no funds. You have to seek for loans, which does not go away for the system.
Do you also think that the university system can be exonerated from these leadership problems?
Well, if you look at it from an aspect, you will say no, it cannot. You know, because at the end of the day, yeah, you begin to relate the faulty leadership from the system itself, on the ground that the system produced them. You know, but you equally need to look at it from the other angle. How did the system get to the point of producing this kind of persons? Was that the position from the beginning? You know, we had an education system that was so viable to the point that foreigners were coming. You know, we had such an attractive position at the beginning when there were no oil funds. It was even cocoa and granite and the rest of it. So if we can get this thing right from that point, to the point that it was attractive to people from outside, the how come it is now we are, you know, getting to this level? You know, so on that ground, you will say that the problem is actually from the leader. And to start with, every system, the collapse of every system is actually a leadership issue. It's always from the top.
But again, you know, the government over time has done what you would want to say is commendable. They've always appointed people from the academic. So when we have people who should know,
yes,
also, well, interface between your union and the government,
yes,
it means that they, I think they're almost right, and ASU is wrong on this. Because, for instance, the professor who heads the Minister of Education,
yes,
well, hasn't maybe been speaking in the same manner which ASU has been speaking to the government.
You're right.
In other words, she has an inkling into what exactly is happening. Perhaps ASU is wrong on this.
Now, you need to ask, was she nominated by ASU?
Does it really matter?
It does. She's not a representative of ASU.
How does it matter?
But she's a product of the system, no, and she was picked from the system.
Yeah, but whose interest is she serving? Is it the interest of the system or the interest? Who does she report to? Does she report to the system?
Should ASU be nominating?
No. I'm not asking for ASU to nominate, but what I'm saying is that the woman who is not the Minister of Education, for instance, does not serve the interest of ASU. She serves the interest of whoever appointed her. It's always so with every minister. You know, sometimes, you know, a number of times we criticize ministers and the rest of it, but you need to find out first and foremost, whose interest is a minister supposed to serve?
Is it not the interest of the people? Let's get this straight.
Get it this way. If you say the interest of the people, was it the people that appointed the person? Is the person that appointed you that you will serve?
It's interesting.
The instruction. But if you say that the one who appointed you has the whole, you know, commitment.
But they're all working for the good of the people.
Ideally, that is the ideal situation.
Ideally.
Yeah, that's the ideal situation. But that is not what is. What is that whoever appointed you will tell you what to do. And when you even want to veer away from that and advise the person, this is what I want. And that is what you will do for as long as you want to remain an appointee of the person.
And you cannot step aside to maintain your, you can preserve your integrity.
Yeah, if you feel that your integrity is going to be compromised, the best you can do is to resign. That's all. Outside that, if you think you are going to serve the interest of anybody, it's not true. It's only the one who brought you in.
I'm looking at this particular comparison about, you know, the people. Because, you know, there is a process.
Mm-hmm.
People are nominated to go through ministerial screening,
yeah,
before they are finally made ministers,
yeah,
right? So because they went through ministerial screening sometimes, and the Senate is supposed to represent the people, we're supposed to say that the people,
yeah,
have indeed endorsed these ministers, right? But also looking at it, you will also know that, or you would also imagine that the administration is not out to fail in the area of education. It wants to be able to thump its chest and say, we did well in this particular area. So why would you believe that, you know, the minister would be serving, you know, certain other interests aside what should be the best interest of ASU and indeed the education system?
Yeah, but I think we are saying the same thing. What I'm saying, in essence, just like you are trying to say, is that yes, on a normal day, what you have said ought to be on a normal day. You know, but look at it this way. Supposing you say this is what is good for the system, and a man, you know, who is in charge of the entire system says, no, this is what I feel we should do, what would you do? Would you say, okay, you must do this? No. So that tells you that the buck ends on somebody's table. Now, that is a final position to determine what is good for the system. As a matter of fact, it is the president that determines what is good for the system in the system. Otherwise, having entered into an agreement, why will you need another negotiation?
You talked about how the agreement also provides room for renegotiation.
Yeah, but you have not even implemented. How do you go into a renegotiation where you've not implemented? So what is the guarantee that when you now renegotiate, you will even implement? So should we keep on negotiating and renegotiating without...
Is it that they have not implemented any part of it?
It has not.
Apart from the lecturer...
It is only the issue of 70 years. And that is what they are overblowing, as if there's something very fantastic about it. That they've now increased the age, the service years of a professor.
Yeah, but by the way, there were criticisms about that particular clause. Others thought that if you increase that to 70 and make it at that,
yes.
What happens to those who are coming up? What time are you going to give them to get into the system and then make their own impact as well?
Yeah, but you equally need to worry about what happens in other climes. Those professors, because when they leave here, they go to other universities, even outside the country. They are well received. And they perform well. So, what happened to those places? Are you saying that new people don't come in? Why should ours be different? You know, it's a question of...
Can't we tailor ours to...